In today's video, we're going to have a look at 5 upgrades that you can add to your Pi running Home Assistant. Check it out.
If it's software, he knows it. If it's techie, he'll show it. If it's something fancier, something janky, it's Mark 1 Tech. You can automate it and try not to break it. It's Mark 1 Tech.
That was different. What's going on, guys? I hope you're all doing well. Recently, I've been asked a lot about the various different setups and upgrades that I make use of with my Pis running Home Assistant. So we're going to be having a quick look at 5 different upgrades that I personally use. If you've got a really cool upgrade that you personally make use of that's different to these 5, then let me know in the comments below. As always, this video will be chaptered, so if there's a particular upgrade that you want to have a look at, then be sure to make use of those timestamps in the description below. Our first upgrade is going to have to be the Ice Tower Heatsink. Essentially what this thing is just a big heatsink that sits on top of your Pi, and it's just going to keep your Pi super cool. I personally love the aesthetics of the Ice Tower, and I'm also a fan of the RGB fan. If you don't like the RGB fan, it does also come with a plain fan, so you can swap this out and just have a plain clear fan. The Ice Tower is compatible with both the Raspberry Pi 3 and the Raspberry Pi 4, and all you do with it is just literally sit it on top of it, put some thermal paste down, and then screw it in place. When the Ice Tower's on and running, I wouldn't say it's noticeably loud, but it does offer 2 different modes of speed. So you've got the full speed cooling mode and you've got the quiet cooling mode. To actually swap between the 2 modes, all you need to do is just change the voltage supplied to the fan. So you can either connect it to the 5 volt rail or the 3 volt rail. With the main Ice Tower kit, you obviously get the main Ice Tower heatsink and you get the 2 different fans that I previously mentioned. In addition to that, you also get some other heatsinks to cover your Raspberry Pi components. And you also get this nice bottom acrylic plate. The acrylic plate's got some little holes in to allow some heat to escape, and it's also got a cutout to allow you to insert your memory cards. One thing I don't like about the Ice Tower is if you happen to be running it like this, so with no external enclosure, so as I'd call this, a naked Pi. If you're running it as a naked Pi, then the fan does have a tendency to choke up a bit, so over time it just gets clogged up with a bit of dust, and that can just make the fan jitter a bit and actually can make the fan make a bit of noise. So if you are hearing a bit of noise or hearing that kind of jittery noise, then you'll know that you need to clean it out. But if you do happen to run it like that, then you can just clean it and you won't really get that issue. And that issue isn't specific to this thing, it's with any kind of electronics that you have exposed. And probably more so when you've got a big old fan sitting on the top just sucking in dust all day. If you're interested in picking one of these up, it's going to cost you just under £20 in the UK and just over $20 in the US. Home Assistant wise, with the Ice Tower attached, the Pi usually has a temperature of about 35 degrees, and this stays very cool even when I'm doing things like viewing camera streams, streaming media, and running lots of different automations and add-ons. You can see here we've got a graph of the processor's temperature throughout the day, so you can see it's pretty averaged all the way through. We've got some lows here of about 31 degrees and some spikes there of about 40 and 41. These results are from the Ice Tower running in its quiet cooling mode, so this is where it's using less power and generating less noise. One feature that this fan doesn't have that some others do is active cooling, so when it's plugged in it's just constantly running at the same speed, but it would be nice that when it's idling if it could use a bit less power and maybe slow down the revolutions of the fan. But all in all, I am a fan of this fan. Up next we've got a bit of a cure for our naked Pi, and that's a case. This specific case is a 3D printed case that's designed to house a Raspberry Pi 4 and the Ice Tower. Which is great as it means we get to keep our lovely cooled Pi, but we also get a nice enclosure to house it all. Now one of the nice things about this specific case is you get an extra fan with it, so you have a fan on the front and also a fan on the side. So by utilising this specific case, our Pi is now even cooler. The trade-off to having this extra fan is extra power consumption and extra noise. Now for me personally, the noise doesn't bother me whatsoever, and the power consumption is very minimal. If you own a 3D printer, then you could just design and print your own case, or you could download somebody else's stencil and just print that out. And if you don't own a 3D printer, you can just jump online and do a search for Ice Tower compatible Pi cases, which is exactly what I did for this one. This specific case was from Etsy, but you could buy one pretty much anywhere online. I think it cost about £40, and if you do want this specific case, I'll have a link to it in the description below. Some other cool features that this case has is it has these mesh filters, so that's going to help keep all that dust out and it will stop me complaining like before. It's also got these cool clear acrylic sides which have got Raspberry Pi logos etched onto them, so you have it on the side and also on the top. Now, some people that sell these offer different logos, so you could have your own logo printed or your own design etched onto the top and side. It's also got some nice ventilation on the back and a slot for your SD card. Okay, up next we've got arguably one of the most important features for running Home Assistant on a Pi, and that's an SSD. If you had to choose just one of the five upgrades that I'm showing you today, then I'd definitely recommend it be the SSD. With the SSD, you get an absolutely huge speed boost in comparison to an SD card, and it's also much, much more reliable. If you're currently sat there running Home Assistant on an SD card and you have been thinking of making the jump to an SSD, then just do it. To help with this, I've made a whole bunch of different videos on how to set up Home Assistant on an SSD, and I also cover things like migrating from an SD card to an SSD. So if you're interested in that, then go and check those videos out. They should be linked above and also in the description. And just to tie our upgrades together, you may have noticed that on this case, it's got this little tray on the bottom, and the purpose of that tray is to actually hold the SSD. So with this, the SSD just slides into the bottom. You can then just connect the SSD to your Pi using a SATA to USB 3 cable. You can get really short cables or L-shaped cables so they don't have this big overhang like I've got here, which would help tidy up the design a little bit. So at this point now, we've got a Pi with dual fans, a nice case, and the speeds of an SSD. And you can also have those fancy RGB fans if that's something you're into. The fourth upgrade is all about backup power for your Pi with the aims of keeping Home Assistant running even if you've had a power cut. And we're going to be doing that with one of these. So this thing is the Pi Sugar 2, and you should think of it as kind of like a small UPS for your Pi. In the UK it costs just under £50, and I think in the US it's also just under $50. You're probably looking at the cost of that and thinking to yourself, I could get two or three external battery packs for the cost of just one of these. And yes, you could. Typically, external battery packs are much bigger and you can get smaller ones, but the benefits of this thing is it integrates directly into your Pi. So the Pi Sugar has two parts. You've got the actual battery and then you've got the control board. The control board fastens to the Raspberry Pi and it directly interfaces with the Pi's GPIO pins. With the Pi Sugar connected to your Pi, you can install a bit of software that allows you to control and manage the battery. This little bit of software allows you to create a schedule for when your Pi should wake up. On the control board, there's a little button and you can assign actions to those buttons, so you could have something like a double tap to shut down the Pi. You can also set a safe shutdown level, so if the Pi is being powered by the Pi Sugar and the battery reaches a set level, then the Pi is going to automatically do a safe shutdown. And this is going to prevent the Pi from getting any damage or your SD card or SSD getting any kind of corruption. And you can obviously also view the battery level of the Pi Sugar. So if you're doing this with Home Assistant, if you're running Home Assistant OS, then you won't be able to install this as you can't add anything on like this. But if you're running it supervised or you've got it in Docker or something like that, then you can add this on. As a fun little project, I'm actually working to get the information from this into Home Assistant OS, but that's going to be for another video. And in that video, I'll also be doing a full review of this thing. Another thing to point out is you don't actually have to use any software to make use of the Pi Sugar. You can just plug it into your Pi and then should the power go, it can automatically switch to the power of the battery. This is just one UPS option and it also happens to fit nicely inside of that case with the ice tower. If you're making use of a UPS with your Pi and Home Assistant, then let me know in the comments below which one it is you're using. Alternatively, if you're making use of a Pi Sugar and you have integrated it into Home Assistant, then let me know. I'd be interested in having a look at your project. Our fifth and final upgrade takes some of the features of the upgrades that we've already looked at and combines them all down into one small package. And of course, it's the Argon One M2. I've previously covered installing Home Assistant on the Argon One M2, so if you're interested in that, there'll be a link to it in the description below. This is a great premium case and it's got some really cool features. It's got things like active cooling, M2 storage, color-coded GPIO pins, and two full HDMI ports. And those are just some of the features. This case will cost you about £50 in the UK and about $45 in the US. Home Assistant wise, you can get an add-on for the Argon One that allows you to control the Argon One's fan speeds. This allows you to adjust the speed of the fan based on the Pi's temperature. And there we go, that's been a quick look at five of the upgrades that I like to make use of with my Home Assistant and Pi setups. If you have enjoyed this video, don't forget to drop me a like. And if you're not already, hit that subscribe button and ding dong the notification bell. You'll then be alerted to any future video that I do. As always, a massive thank you to these awesome dudes. These awesome dudes are my Patreons. If you're interested in becoming one of these awesome dudes, then there'll be a link to my Patreon in the description below. So thank you for watching, and let me know what you think of this little jingle. Cheers.
So thank you for watching, and if you like the show, please hit that subscribe button, it's just down below. Go check out my videos, and don't you forget, for smart home software, automation, and more, it's Mark One Tech. It's Mark.